गुड आफ्टरनून स्टूडेंट्स, गुड आफ्टरनून
सर।
स्टूडेंट्स, गुड इवनिंग। यस, गुड आफ्टरनून।
यस
ओके, सो वी विल मूव ऑन टू द लेक्चर टुडे। सो इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर वी स्टार्टेड टू डिस्कस अबाउट द फाइबर्स एंड इट्स इम्पोर्टेंस इन द कंपोजिट। वी हैव डिस्कस्ड व्हाट इज द इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ द फाइबर एंड व्हाट आर इट्स फंक्शंस एंड what is the importance of the fiber in the tensile property. We have discussed when you make a composite, it is the fiber that is fiber, or you can say it is the reinforcement that is going to carry the load. Okay, it is not the matrix that is going to carry the load, it is the reinforcement that is going to carry load. And there are many types of reinforcements are there, like fiber, metal or ceramic. So we have been discussing on fibers. So we have started to discuss about various fibers, and especially about glass fibers. We had a discussion in detail what is glass fiber manufacture, its structure, and different forms of glass fibers. Those things we have learned. Okay. So up to here we discussed advantages and disadvantages. So we'll move further to next fiber, which you have not learned so far, which is called the boron fibers. Okay, it is another high performance fiber to be understood. So this is a different manufacturing route of this fiber is much different when you compare it with the fibers like glass or other fibers like aramid. This fiber is a different manufacturing route. So how these fibers are manufactured? These are manufactured by chemical vapor deposition. Okay, this is a method called chemical vapor deposition. So how this process is done, that we are going to see how this manufacturing process is done. So from the word itself you can understand chemical vapor deposition. Some chemical is there which is transformed into vapor and it will get deposited on a surface. Okay, that is the understanding. So in a place where there is a high vacuum, in that place there is some reaction is going to occur. In that reaction, some chemicals are going to react, and that chemical will release a volatile substance that will deposit on a surface. Okay. See, for this fiber, boron fiber manufacture, you require a tungsten wire or a carbon monofilament. Okay, you require a tungsten wire or a carbon monofilament, because over this surface of this tungsten wire or the carbon monofilament only, the boron will get formed. And how will the boron form? It will be formed through a chemical reaction. You need to react two chemicals. One is the boron trichloride and another is the hydrogen gas. So these two undergo a reaction to produce boron. Okay, with the liberation of hydrochloric acid. So how to perform this process? For this I told you, you need these two reactants. One is the boron trichloride and another is the hydrogen, and you need a substrate like a tungsten wire of some particular diameter, say 0.0127 millimeter diameter. You require a tungsten wire or a carbon monofilament. And then there is a chamber. For a more clarity, I will show you a picture for your better understanding. So here you just see this simple setup, which you can see here. This is the let-off spool and this is the take-up spool, from where the tungsten wire or the carbon monofilament is passed. So here there is a closed chamber which is called a cleaning chamber, and this is the deposition chamber. Here you see normally the chamber is completely cleaned. Completely cleaned with the help of a nitrogen gas. You are doing some purging, so the chamber would not contain any kind of a moisture or anything. So you clean them. Then what you do is hydrogen gas is continuously passed inside, because as you are seeing in the reaction, in the presence of hydrogen gas only this reaction takes place. And then over this deposition chamber, this is the place where the chemical vapor deposition is taking place. Here this hydrogen gas and this boron trichloride is going to react, and then that boron will get formed on the surface of the tungsten. It will just form on the surface and it will diffuse inside the tungsten. So this reaction is happen at a very high temperature, say around 1100 to 1300 degrees centigrade, because at this temperature only this boron will get formed. Okay, so this boron trichloride and this hydrogen undergo reaction to produce boron at a very high temperature of say around 1100 to 1300 degrees centigrade, where the tungsten wire is continuously pulled inside the chamber, where the hydrogen gas is supplied, and simultaneously this hydrogen and the boron trichloride undergo reaction to, so that boron will get formed on the surface of the tungsten wire or the carbon monofilament. So in this reaction process, you can change the process parameters like the speed of pulling or the deposition temperature and the diameter of the wire. Those things you can vary so that you will get a better boron reinforcement over the wire. Now, commercially, if you observe, these boron fibers are produced in diameters like 0.1, 0.142 and 0.203 meter. These are much larger than those of the other reinforcing fibers. Okay. So it's a very simple kind of a setup. See, for example, if you are using this process, you can either use boron trichloride or some other kind of a chemical also is possible to be used as a precursor to manufacture this boron fiber. So here you see the tungsten substrate, which is present, which you have seen here in this diagram. This tungsten substrate, it will get converted into tungsten bromide. Okay, so this will be, initially it was just a tungsten wire, because of the presence of boron which has got attached over the surface of the tungsten and diffused inside. So it is the tungsten boride. Okay, so tungsten boride is formed so that you can say, though it is chemically, it is a tungsten boride, you can call them as a boron fiber. Okay. So here the diameter, you can see initially the diameter was 0.0127 millimeter. It increased to 0.0165 millimeter because of the boron that is formed on the surface and the core. Okay. So here you can see that depending upon how much, how the boron has undergone the diffusion inside the tungsten, so that it will give that much of a good compressive resistance, so that otherwise what will happen if the surface only the surface it is deposited and not have diffused inside, in that case what will happen, it will be more sensitive to any kind of a damage, so that fiber may, the boron will come out. So that's those things have to be taken care in the process by using the proper temperature, speed of pulling, and what type of vacuum you are using inside, vacuum maintenance inside, and the chemicals that your reactants that are in, changing the concentration of the reactants, those things to be taken care of, so that you will get a good compressive resistance. Okay. So here you see there is another process called, another fiber similar to boron called the borsic fiber. This is a more improved form of a fiber, fibers when compared to boron. For this, what you can do is, instead of using the boron trichloride, you can use silicon carbide. Okay, silicon carbide can be used, so that that can, instead of just the boron trichloride and the hydrogen, along with that you can make another deposition like silicon carbide, so that what will happen, there will be a one more silica also will get deposited along with the boron. Okay, so that what will happen, there will be more any kind of an adverse reaction that is taking place because of the exposure of the boron on the surface, that will be compensated by the addition of the silica. Okay, so that fiber is called as the borsic fiber, so that because of the, when compared to the highly reactive boron fiber, because boron usually fibers have adverse reaction with the metal, that fiber has some adverse reaction with the metal, so that can be by one more process where the same chemical vapor deposition, where you will deposit the silica carbide that will react to deposit the silica on the surface of the boron fiber. And how, what about the surface morphology of this fiber? This fiber, if you observe, it has a microcrystalline structure. Okay, generally it is called amorphous phase. It would normally, when you observe this fiber in some techniques like X-ray diffraction, where the crystallinity is studied, you can see some amorphous material in the surface. Okay, mostly this amorphous boron fiber, if you see, it will contain some very nanometer size nanocrystalline phase will be present. It will look like a corncob structure. Okay, so if you just observe, like you can see, this is the corn. I think you may be knowing the maize kind of a structure, corncob structure. You can see here, here you can see there are a lot of notes in the surface. You can observe this is called the corncob. You can see the corn, maize type of a vegetable which you may have seen. So here you see these nodules are formed by the reaction of the nucleation for because of the two chemicals, boron trichloride and hydrogen, when it undergoes one chemical and a gas, when it undergoes a reaction, the nucleation will start on the substrate and then go out in the form of a conical form. That is why you get some sort of a bulging type of a structure you can see here in the surface. This is how the morphology of the boron looks like when you observe it in the some technical to analytical techniques like scanning electron microscopy. If you observe, this is how it looks like. And as I told you, the structure is generally amorphous, and you can see that it is mostly composed of 2 nanometer nanocrystalline phase. Okay, it is a very very minute, very very less small size, around 2 nanometer type nanocrystalline phase is present in the structure, and this structure resembles a corncob structure. Okay, just for the surface morphology, if you want to know how it looks like. Okay, then what are the advantages and disadvantages? This fiber has a high tensile modulus because it's a high performance fiber. Obviously, it will have a high tensile modulus around, say, 379 to 414 gigapascal. And it has a large diameter, so that these fibers have a good resistance to buckling. Means if you just to do some, give some compression so that it can withstand the compressive force, so that it will not get deformed with the compression. So that this is the reason why, for providing more compressive, in order to make the fiber to withstand more compressive strength, the silica carbide is given as a one more coating over the surface of the boron, so that the reactivity towards metal is also reduced, and also the compressive strength, the axial direction, whatever the compressive strength that is required, that is also increased because of the silica carbide coating. So the, generally the fiber, you can say boron fibers have a good resistance to buckling and high compressive strength. Density is high. It is around 2.6 grams per centimeter cube, because you see the raw material itself is a tungsten wire, and over that this fiber is formed in the gas phase, so it will have a higher density. But the problem is, it is extremely brittle. It will break. Okay. So it is sensitive to the surface damage. Though it has a good tensile modulus, everything, but still it is a brittle fiber. It is like a, like ceramic fibers. It is a little brittle fiber, extremely brittle and prone to surface damage. Okay. And another disadvantage is, this fibers is very costly. Okay. Even it is higher than many forms of the carbon fibers. That is why it is restricted to some very few aerospace application. Okay, mostly these fibers are high performance fiber that is used in conjunction with a matrix to produce a composite. Okay, like a boron matrix, boron and epoxy, you can mix and make a composite. So that what will happen, that one problem can be solved when you make a composite out of it. or you can just improve the property of the boron so that this can be possible. So that only for very few applications it's used, like aerospace, wherever in the aeroplane some applications, specific type of products to be manufactured for those kind of applications, this boron fibers are used. Okay, so that's all about the boron fibers. Do you understand?
Yes, sir.
Did you understand? Okay. So we shall continue to the next type of a fiber, which you are already familiar with. It's called the carbon fibers. So about carbon fibers, I think you can actually tell me much better, because you have learned this from my previous lectures during the discussion on man-made fibers. I hope we can just make a revision out of it. So carbon fiber is one of the important fibers, we can say very important fiber, used in the composite manufacture. And you know what is the raw material for this fiber manufacturing? The raw material is the polyacrylonitrile. There are some three raw materials can be used to produce this carbon fiber. One is the polyacrylonitrile, otherwise called acrylic, and another is the pitch, which is the byproduct of petroleum, and another is the viscose rayon. Among these three, polyacrylonitrile is more used. Viscose is much less used, and pitch is somewhat also less used, but it is used. So if you see these fibers, main thing is that you are going to burn the PAN fibers at a very high temperature. In some three different steps you are going to follow, and then from the polyacrylonitrile, whatever cyanide group is there, and other oxygen groups are there, whatever is there, all those are going to get removed except the carbon. Okay, and then after the carbon fiber is manufactured, you are going to you are going to use it for the composite manufacturing. Okay, so if you see this flow diagram in the carbon manufacturing, it's very simple to understand. There are two important precursors which is commercially successful. One is the PAN, which is more used, and another is the pitch, which is the byproduct of petroleum. This PAN is an anisotropic fiber, which is the acrylic. From the raw material is the PAN filament. Okay, and here this pitch is the byproduct of petroleum, where you are going to heat them and first give a heat treatment and then convert it into a mesophase pitch. Mesophase in the sense which will behave like a liquid crystal nature, which will have some good orientation. And then after you do some melt, spinning and drawing, you will make the pitch filament. These two, you are going to do these three steps called oxidative stabilization, carbonization and graphitization. Needless to say, I have explained you already all these processes in the previous lecture on carbon. So you will do with every stage what will happen, there will be the elimination of some compounds, like nitrogen will get removed, oxygen will get removed, water will get removed, and in every step there will be a gradual improvement, and finally the graphite like structure will form with only carbon, and your carbon fiber will get formed with a good arrangement, with a proper arrangement. You will form the carbon fibers during the graphitization stage. Okay, because the ordering is very important, because you see carbon fibers, if you heat, you do this process one by one, finally it is the arrangement of the fibers will happen only at the graphitization stage, step where the graphite like layers will form. And this layers, after you stretch it, then only you will get a properly aligned kind of aligned structure you will get. Okay, so you know about what is carbonization, what is graphitization, and what is oxidative stabilization. So I do not want to again speak about the same thing. So with every step there will be an elimination, and there will be the ring fusion. The rings, whichever are separate, that will get fused, and it will form a ladder-like structure. and finally you get a carbon fibers like this. Okay, this is through the PAN, that is the PAN route, which is the polyacrylonitrile route. And for example, if you are not using that, if you are using, if you want to manufacture the carbon through the pitch route, that is also possible. That also we have already discussed. Pitch is the byproduct of petroleum, and you see this pitch also, you convert them, you heat them to some high temperature around say 300 degrees centigrade, so that what will happen, you will produce a mesophase pitch, a highly viscous kind of a polymer melt you will produce. Okay, so this pitch, this mesophase pitch, you see this pitch actually has a liquid crystal domains in the structure. Okay, so that liquid crystal domains will facilitate the orientation when after this if you do the process, when you do the melt spinning and then stretch the filaments, what will happen, it will actually facilitate the molecular orientation. It will facilitate the molecular orientation so that the structure will get stabilized, so that what will happen, that will have a good strength. Okay, but other process remain the same, where the carbonization, graphitization, those process, it is similar to the PAN fiber, PAN route, that is the polyacrylonitrile route. Okay, so this is how the liquid crystal domains, as you recall our discussion on aramid fibers, how the liquid crystals help at a particular concentration of, if you remember, in the aramid fiber manufacture, there was a graph, if you just recall, at a particular concentration of the Kevlar and sulfuric acid, this liquid crystal domains are formed, which has a nature between solid and the liquid. Okay, because why we form this liquid crystal kind of a thing, why not a complete solid or liquid? Because these liquid crystals help to align the molecules in the fiber axis direction, so that you will get improved mechanical properties. Okay, so this will happen at a particular concentration and the at a particular temperature and pH, so that you align the mesophase pitch into a pitch filament. Okay, and structure of carbon, yes, that is, we should know about this, because for the composite manufacturing, rather than the emphasis on the manufacturing part, you should know more about how the morphology of the carbon fiber looks like and how that influences the properties. That is of more important. You see, structurally, the carbon fibers contain a blend of amorphous carbon and graphitic carbon. Okay, so here you see, when the carbon fibers have a higher tensile modulus, it is because of the graphitic carbon. These are arranged in some plane in the hexagonal form with some particular size along the planes, around 3.4 angstrom between the each plane. And you can see the structure which I have showed you previously. Between every two carbon atoms in the graphite crystal, there is a distance, intra-atomic distance of say around 3.4 angstrom, and between every two carbon-carbon bonds, you can see there is a distance of around 1.42 angstrom between the two adjacent carbon atoms. Okay, and how these carbon atoms are held? It is held through the covalent bonds. Okay, normally these bonds, the strong covalent bond exists between the carbon atoms. In each plane, if you see, there is a strong covalent bond exists, but on the contrary, you see the bond between the planes, this is one plane and this is another, like this, there is a arrangement of many planes, okay, many basal planes. Those ultimately, you see that bond between the planes is little weaker, like a van der Waals force of attraction is exist between the plates. So because of this, you see, this fiber is highly anisotropic fiber. Okay, it is highly anisotropic fiber, and mechanical properties of the fiber, it very much direction dependent. That is, you need to understand, because in axial direction, the property of the mechanical property will be different, and the circumferential proper direction, transverse direction, it will be different. That you have to understand. Okay, so here the basal planes, as I have shown you, these are aligned along the fiber axis. It is aligned, but the property in both the direction, axial direction and the transverse direction, they are different. Because you can see the alignment that is existing in the carbon fiber in the transverse direction, it can be circumferential, radial, random, or combination of these arrangements. Okay, I will just show you a diagram that will better explain how the arrangement of graphite crystals in the direction of the fiber axis. Okay, so for example, here the axial direction, it is fine, but in the transverse direction, you see here it is in the form of circumferential, and here you can see it is in the form of radial. Here it is randomly distributed. Okay, and here you can see both circumferential and radial, and here both circumferential and random. Okay, so this is the crystal arrangement. The crystal arrangement in the axial direction and transverse direction, it is not same. That is why it is highly anisotropic. This thing is very important for your understanding. That is why you see when you do the testing, like such as when you study some properties like a modulus or coefficient of thermal expansion or tensile strength, impact strength, those kind of tests, if you carry out, you will feel that it is not same in both the direction. If you take a fiber and do it in the axial direction, the strength will be different, and do it in the transverse direction, the strength will be different. The modulus also will be different in both the direction. The change in the dimensional stability after you apply some give some temperature to the particular carbon material, there will be an expansion, there will be a change in the increase in the size of the material. Okay, so that will, that is also direction dependent, because in the transverse direction and the longitudinal direction, the properties are different. Okay, and how it is described, for example, if an arrangement is circumferential, something like this, this is circumferential. In that case, EA, that is the axial direction, equal to E theta is greater than ER, means in circumferential direction will be greater than the radial direction. Okay, if the fiber is said to be circumferentially, it is called the circumferentially orthotropic. For example, if it is a radial, where the crystals are aligned in the radial direction, just you recall our lecture on melt spinning, there are three types of we discussed at the quenching systems, radial flow, cross flow, inflow, outflow. So this is the radial, same radial kind of thing, where it is over the radius it is present. Okay, so here you see in the radial arrangement, the radial direction will have more property than can compare to the circumferential direction. Okay, that is why it is called the radially orthotropic. Means, for example, orthotropic means where the surface have some different properties in some three different direction, like x, y, z. So at every the property will be different in all the three, like in the radial form, circumferential form, and in other form. Like, for example, if it is a radial or random or circumferential, all these different all the properties will be different. Okay, so wherever the arrangement, whichever arrangement is favoring, depending upon that, you can say whether it is circumferentially orthotropic or whether it is radially orthotropic or whether it is transversely isotropic. So these things are decided based on the arrangement of the graphite crystals in the transverse direction. Okay, so here you see, yes
sir, what is about weight modulus of this carbon fiber?
Yeah, we will discuss about it. I will come to you. See, when in the commercial fibers, you see there is a two zone structure where the circumferential arrangement in the skin and either radial or random arrangement in the core. Okay, So commercially, carbon fibers, if you purchase, there will be two zones. One is the circumferential arrangement, where in the circumference skin, and either radial or random arrangement in the core. Okay, so this is the core where inside. So here it will be radial or random arrangement, and at the surface, okay, you have a circumferential arrangement in the skin. And you see, this is about the different properties, how it is different because of their different arrangement of crystals in the axial and the transverse direction. What next is the categories of carbon fibers. You see, carbon fibers can be classified into three important categories. One is called the high tensile strength, high modulus, and ultra high modulus. Okay, these three are the important categories of carbon. Just to see here in this table, you can see these are the properties of the commercially available reinforcing fibers like glass, carbon, pitch carbon, aramid. But now we are going to discuss only about the carbon. Okay, so here you see this T3, these two are the high tensile strength carbon fibers. T, which is shown here, this is the ultra high modulus carbon fibers, and T40 and IEM, it is the IEM, which means it is not IEM, it is a spelling mistake, you can correct it. It is actually the high modulus, it is not I, it should be H. It is the high modulus, and this is the ultra high. That is shown here. For example, if you say T300, if you see T300 have the diameter of around 7 microns, density is low. Tensile modulus, you see, it is higher, around 231. Tensile strength is much higher, 0.65 gigapascal, and the strain to failure is very high because strain to failure is another important property where the elongation to break it is much higher. So that though this material has a good strength, it's a highly ductile type of a material where it can be drawn into wires. Okay, so depending upon that, you see one important thing, coefficient of thermal expansion in the longitudinal direction, it is minus 0.6, but whereas in the radial direction, it is 7 to 12. Okay, so you can understand the property of both the direction becomes different. Similar things, if you measure the strain to failure or the tensile strength in also will be direction dependent. If you compare the properties of you can separate the properties of the fibers into high tensile strength, ultra high modulus, and high modulus. For example, if you see this what is this? This UHM, which is the GY70 kind of a thing. The diameter with this T300, here it has a higher diameter because it is a high modulus. So stiffness will be higher. You understand? The diameter, when it becomes more the stiff, the fiber becomes more stiff. So obviously the density will also be higher. You can see 1.76, it has increased to 1.96. And the tensile modulus also increased because this is a very high ultra modulus. Okay, high ultra modulus. So it is 483 gigapascal. And but whereas you see tensile strength, if you observe with this T300, it is lesser. Okay, that is important to observe. And the strain to failure is also less. Okay, so wherever strength will be lesser. Okay, it is not possible to have both the things in a very equal amount. Okay, so this is why we separate them based on the solar induced application. We may need a high tensile strength, but we may not require a high modulus. For some applications, we may require a high modulus, and we may not require that much of a strength. For example, if you see in composite manufacturing, when compared to strength, the more important thing is the modulus. Okay, the modulus is most important. Okay, So we use some high modulus fibers, but that is not, it is not like that where that strength is not required. We require a high strength, but modulus stiffness is very much important. Okay, so that you can just go through the table so that you can appreciate how these properties are direction dependent and how the tensile strength and modulus and the coefficient of thermal expansion, it is different in both how it is different for carbon fiber that is manufactured from pan root and from the pitch root, you can appreciate. Now coming to the generally discussion on properties between pan and pitch. Through both these precursors, you can manufacture the carbon fiber. But the properties, if you observe, it is different if you use both the carbon from the same carbon fibers are manufactured through different precursors. But you can see how the properties are different. You see, the pan-based fibers have a higher tensile strength. Okay. But whereas the pitch-based fibers have a lower tensile strength. It is relative. It is comparison between these two precursors. But whereas modulus is lower for pan-based fiber, but whereas it is higher for the pitch-based fibers, and compressive strength, it is again direction dependent for higher for pan fibers in the axial direction and lower for the pitch-based carbon. And the strain to failure, that is the elongation to break, it is much higher for pan fibers. So you can say the ductility is higher for the pan fibers, and but whereas for the pitch, it is lower. And thermal conductivity and electrical conductivity, both are lower for the pan-based fiber, but for the pitch-based fiber, this property is higher. Okay, but in general, you can tell that carbon fibers in general have a good many conductive applications wherever the conductivity it is required, this carbon fibers are used. So this is just a relative comparison between the both the precursors. If you just you can just read these properties and just compare with the table which is shown, the pitch based carbon and the pan-based carbon, you will get a better understanding. And you see how carbon fibers are available, in what forms it is available. We have just seen the classification of the carbon fibers but in commercially, in what form you can use for the composite, you can see like a collection of bundle of fibers, like something like a toe, long and continuous toe, you can is available, which is around 5 to 10 micrometer. And then chopped type of a carbon is available, milled type of a carbon is available, around 30 to 3000 millimeter long, which is around chopped means which is around cut, the toe is cut into some pieces. Okay. And you see this long and continuous toe, which is normally an untwisted bundle, contains lot of filaments, around say 1000 to around 160,000 parallel filaments. This filaments can be used in the high performance application in the composite manufacture also. See, if you see this four different form, this is the completely the powder, okay, in the powder form, which is like a milled type of a fiber. And here you can see this is something, these are the continuous toe. And here you can see this is the prepreg. Okay, prepreg, you remember our lecture, on the previous lecture, we have discussed what is a prepreg. It is a pre-impregnated fibers, where the fibers, carbon fibers have already impregnated with the resin, and then fabric. The fabric is already impregnated with the resin, and it is not cured completely. It is just a semi-cured type of a system. Okay, so that once if you use some 3-4 prepregs and arrange them without using the matrix also, you can just send it to the oven and then make a composite, because already the resin is inside. Okay, and this is the chopped type of a carbon fibers. Okay, these are the milled type of a fibers, where the fibers are ground into small micron size, around say 30 to 3000 millimeter long, very small powder. Okay, advantage of the carbon fiber is, it has a high tensile strength to weight ratio. Means, what does this mean? For a small weight, the strength will be very higher. Okay? And for a small weight, the modulus will be very higher. That is what I told. If you want for any end use application where the strength, if you want to be very higher, you can use a high tensile strength type of a carbon fiber. Or if you, the application dictates the use of high modulus, in that case you can use the high modulus, tensile modulus kind of a carbon fiber. That is also possible. Next is coefficient of thermal expansion. Unlike the metal, which has a very high coefficient of thermal expansion, I hope you know what is the coefficient of thermal expansion. If you apply some heat, the material just expand in the size. Okay, so for metal, the coefficient of thermal expansion is high, but whereas here in the carbon fibers, in general, you can say many high performance fibers have a low coefficient of thermal expansion, so that that can be used in some application like space antenna, wherever there is a high temperature exposure, it will not get, it will not change its dimensional stability. And the next is the high fatigue strength. Whenever it undergoes any cyclic loading and unloading, this will not undergo fatigue failure, so it has a good fatigue strength, unlike the glass fibers. Okay, just think, recall the property of fatigue strength when compared with the glass fiber. This has a higher fatigue strength and higher thermal conductivity, even higher than that of the copper. And another property is the disadvantage, which you need to know. Though these fibers have a number of advantages, there are some many disadvantages also. One is that low strain to failure. Okay, with a very less strain itself, it undergoes failure. Okay, and the next is the another important disadvantage is the low impact resistance. I hope you may be knowing what is meant by impact resistance. Okay, for this fiber cannot easily absorb the energy, more energy. For example, if you are using this carbon fibers in an application where there is a bulletproof coat or anything, if you are using, in that case, what will happen? The bulletproof coat should absorb more energy. Okay. It should absorb more energy for to deflect the bullets. So this fiber have a low impact resistance. If anything is impacting on the surface, it cannot absorb and then dissipate the energy. It will undergo the impact failure. That is why you see this impact resistance. The best example for the impact resistance in carbon fiber is during the when the aeroplane. Blades, you must have seen the aeroplane blades. When the bird is just hitting on the aeroplane blade, that that will undergo the fiber gets broken. The blade will get broken when the bird is just impacting. When the aeroplane is flying at the sky, when the bird is hitting on the blades, that will undergo a impact failure. So that is why carbon fibers are very rarely used alone. It is always used as a composite. It is always used to make the composite rather than using the. So always it is preferably, it has to be made into composite so that this direction dependent property and problems that are existing in that can be managed. Okay, it has a high electrical conductivity. That is very good for some application, but in some application where if you are using it in the electrical appliances, because of some earthing problem, some short circuiting may take place and it will create some problem. So that is there, but it is otherwise helpful for other applications wherever the conductivity is useful. For those applications, this conductivity is greatly advantageous. Okay, that you can read about where this conductivity is used. It's a very interesting the conductivity is very helpful to protect the electrical equipments from any kind of damage is there, that you can read about it. And it is a costly fiber, like boron fiber. This is a costly, no, not costly like boron. This is also a costly fiber. So it is restricted to use more in the aerospace industry, where the cost is not that important, where the quality is more important and weight saving is more important, because it has a higher tensile strength and tensile modulus to weight ratio. Weight will be less and tensile strength will be higher. Okay, so that is restricted to use in some sophisticated industries where the cost is not that important and the quality is important. Okay, so that's all about the discussion on carbon fibers.